Okay, so I'm Ruche. I work with Tanishq and to take care of their digital marketing bit of it. So like the social media and all e-commerce part of it. So my talk is totally not related to marketing or branding. It's actually something that I'm very passionate about. It's about technology because I've been coding since a very early age and I found this thing and I thought that, you know, every one of us can make a little bit of difference. So I thought, last time was my talk on accessibility, how we can make a software accessible. This time it's more on how can you help society to be, you know, it's the other way. How can a pool of small resources be combined to let's say, solve problems which are of very high scale. So, you know, so I'll start with the thing that when I was in sixth or seventh class, okay. So then the bio came into picture with science and I came to know that there are diseases which are not curable. And there are problems that are at a global level, which cannot be, let's say, solved with the help of limited resources. Like the cancer is incurable, the AIDS is incurable. There are medications to prevent or slow down the growth, but they are not curable. So I just went online, searched, why is it like that? Why there are problems which cannot be solved? Because I always believe that there is a solution to every problem. I always like imbibed that and went ahead with it, thinking that there is a solution to everything. So then I searched and I found that the problem is a lot of research scientists or universities who are, let's say, doing this kind of research are funded by a lobby of a company which they want a specific result to come out of it. And independent researchers which really have some impact or something are not really funded by companies because, okay, fine, clean water, who will fund it? I mean, there is no corporation who's going to gain benefit out of it, right? It's just for the benefit of the society. While if you do a research whether sugar is the cause for diabetes, Coca-Cola will definitely come ahead and fund it and ask the company to work towards the end goal that sugar is not the reason the diabetes is there. So there, I mean, researches like that get funded very well because the end objective or the result is already predefined by the companies, right? But the important researches which are actually meaningful for the society are not funded. And if they are not funded, the computation power required is not there with them because people cannot afford supercomputers, universities cannot afford supercomputers. Now, let me give an example. The folding, human podium folding project requires analysis of each cell and their nucleus and the construction of a human body in depth so that we can find out what are the chemicals and how do they react on these cells. So let's say if there is a problem, like a cancer or a AIDS which is destroying your RBC count and stuff like that, then you need to understand the function of each cell and how chemicals react to it. Now, this kind of research requires massive amount of computing power. Or let's say if you have to forecast economic downturns, or you have to forecast weather, or you have to forecast population growth, geometric progression population growth, what will be the population of the world in 2025? You have to factor so many things. The variables which are there in the equation are so huge that a small computer or, you know, cannot do it. So what is the solution to this? So the concept of grid computing came to existence. It came to existence in 1997 and it got really popular. It's not a very old phenomena because it got popular only in 2004 when big companies came forward and said, okay, let us do it as part of our CSR. Like the tech companies like IBM came forward. That's the only time when the grid computing got the limelight that it always deserved. So grid computing is nothing but it's like a combination of so many nodes connected together in such a way that once the combination of all the processing powers of these clients is, you can imagine it like a virtual computer, virtual supercomputer. Because in this room, let's say if there are 10 people, each one of them can
donate, let's say, only a few megahertz of their processing power, the ultimate power that a project will achieve will be really big, right? So that is the grid computing concept. It's distributive computing. The nodes are geographically distributed. They are not linked. And there is a server at the end, at the center of all of this infrastructure, who is managing the flow of like how the files will be processed and all. As we go in detail, it will become more clear, but you can imagine it like a network of many computers, and they are using their processing power to solve a bigger problem, which a single computer cannot. This is different from parallel processing, if a little bit of tech here. A parallel processing does only have requires an individual stack of processors to process the information. And the output of one processor is like an intermittent result, which results like different processors to act accordingly. But in grid computing, the results from one client is not is not going to change the algorithm of the program or the output from other clients. So let's say, for example, if there is an if and else kind of a condition, the grid computing is not a suitable solution. The suitable solution for grid computing is really massive problems, which requires a lot of computation. So how grid computing works is there are so many grid projects, right? There is a Bitcoin being one of them. Mm-hmm. We'll go to Bitcoin in detail later. But among them, the most popular one, or the grid which is populated by 6.2 million processors across the globe, is World Community Grid. It is an IBM's initiative, and it was started in 2004. It runs on Boink, B-O-I-N-C client. It's a Berkeley University kind of a software infrastructure that was designed by them. Now, how this grid computing, specifically World Community Grid, and I can talk about it because I actually donate a lot of processing power. I've been donating since 3-4 years. So how it works is, let's say when you're listening to songs or you're just making a PPT, you're actually not using the entire processing power, right? So the processing cycle, which is happening, is not completely utilized because you're not using it entirely. So what Boink does is, or the client that is installed in a computer does is, it detects that the processor is not fully used, okay? And then it distributes, so it goes to the server and tells, hey, I have a processing power which can be of some help. Do you have some project for me? Now, World Community Grid runs multiple projects. One of them is Fight Childhood Cancer at Home, or Find Cure for AIDS, or Find Clean Energy Resources, or Find Clean Water. Now, every individual project requires a different equation or a different computation. But what you can do is, what it does is, when the server says, okay, from project Fight Childhood Cancer at Home, I have one file which is of 20 MB. Now, this 20 MB file requires at least 3.5 hours of processing power on your system, because you're transmitting also what credentials of processor you have. So then the server sends you that file, and then you download that 10 or 20 MB file, and your processor works on it at the background. So, and the best part is, you can set how much of processor power it should use. Should it use 10% of it? Should it use 5% of it? And you can set like a lot of parameters. Let's say if your processing power is above 50%, pause the client. That means if it is working on some file, it will stop working because you are using the processor, right? You need it. You don't want your computer to slow down just because you're doing something good for the world, because then nobody will install it. So what it does is, you can set conditions in the client saying, I will only give 5 GB of space of my hard disk and certain amount of processing power when my processing power dips below 50%. So depending on all the situations, it goes ahead and downloads the file. And what it does is, actually, so the huge equation that I was talking about, right, comparing so many chemicals and their reactions to human cell, it tries to do a very, very small chunk of it. And then when it is done processing that particular chunk of it, it uploads the final output result back to the server. And the role of server is to get these files from different processor or different nodes, let's say, and assemble and give the final result to the scientists. Now, it's so simple, right? I mean, why wouldn't you just keep your computer online and be a part of something like this rather than just turning it off? On desktops, it makes much more sense. You can set the battery limitations, how much power it is consuming, it'll also show you. Let's say how much power the client is consuming from to operate, and it's very, very less. You can set it to minimal power usage. The customizable settings are very much, you just have to set it up after you have registered. So what happens is then you're contributing to the researches just by keeping just by donating the unused processing power of your nodes.
How do you do it
is okay, so for World Community Grid, at least I can tell you, is you have to go to the website, that is worldcommunitygrid.org, and you have to register. Register is a simple five-step process. First, you have to register with your email ID, your username, password. This is used to identify you on the grid, because when you do something or when you solve a particular problem, World Community Grid Central server gives you points. Now, these points are not redeemable, but still shows how much of work or task you have you done, how much of, let's say I've contributed 15 days of processing power for Fight AIDS at Home project. So you know that at which kind of, what causes are you fighting for mainly? What causes have been used by? So you can track how much, what time you were online, it automatically does it. After you've signed up, you have to go to downloads and download the client. Now it's a Boeing client, which is generally used for these kind of systems. Once you download it, you have to just check whether is it behind a firewall or proxy. It will automatically do it. So it will try to commit a server and it will see whether you are behind a proxy or a firewall. After that, what you have to do is just, it will actually add itself to the startup, auto startup. And whenever you start a computer, the client will automatically launch in background. You can also... It runs on all the platforms. It runs on Mac, it runs on Linux, it runs on Windows, and they have recently came with an Android version.
So you could donate the processing power of your phones and devices as well?
Yeah, but the only condition is your phone should be plugged in and charging, because it uses battery, right? So your phone should be plugged in and charging, it should be connected through Wi-Fi or through your 3G or whatever. You can set data limit also. I don't want to send or receive more than 50 MB a day using this. So after you have set up how much processing power and how much storage you want to contribute, just leave it. It will be running in the background, and it can also be like a screensaver. So you can set a screensaver when your computer is idle. It can show you what are the tasks that you're doing, how much you've contributed, what is the current file that you're working on. And that's pretty much it. I mean, you don't have to really do configurations every time, because it is logging through your ID. It is asking server whether there is something for me, and the server sends it, and you process that file, and then you send it back. So it's like just keeping your computer online and using what anyways would have gone wasted.
So you're basically, dividing the whole algorithm into independent algorithms.
Yeah.
Independent nodes.
Yeah.
So they are pretty much independent.
True.
But the thing is, you know, when somebody and contributing your processing speed won't be a problem. The problem will be the uploads and the downloads.
Okay.
Yeah, you are spending money.
Yeah.
On that. So,
how much is it?
I noticed in a day, I downloaded some in a day, okay, in 24 hours, when my computer, I had a desktop, it downloaded around 60 MB and uploaded around less than that and uploaded.
But how
I think
much of your process did you dedicate?
It was a desktop, so I just set it to maximum utilization. So
it was 60 then?
Yeah, it was 60 then. So I think hardly, if you set it to minimal usage, you will download at least 20-25 MB and upload the similar amount of data, because what you are doing is essentially downloading a file and processing it for, and one file takes at least 2-3 to 4 hours depending on your configuration, depending on what is the priorities or configurations that you've set in the client. I could be running an i7, but if I say I only want to contribute to a very small chunk of project, then that's a limitation. So you can set how much you want to contribute. And
so essentially, I contribute processing power, percentage processing power.
Yeah.
The client, the main client basically distributes that among projects that are that require the processing power. Right?
True.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you choose projects that you want to work on?
Yeah. Yeah. So during sign up process, there are at least, so there are a couple of projects that have already been resolved. Like there was one project to find how to, using the genetic chemicals, how can you produce a rice, which is which you can feed to people, right? The production of, how can the production of rice be increased using whatever chemicals, okay? That project got completed in 2007 because X number of processes donated to it, they discovered, and now they're actually implementing it. So there have been successful projects. The human folding project is, I think, almost coming to a conclusion. Fighting dengue was one of the project which got completed. So they have finally found a solution that can cure dengue completely. But they are like testing it in lab, and it'll take time. But so it requires so much of combination that they came to IBM and said, we want to do it, and it's on request. So you go to IBM, say, this is the amount of processing I require, this will help society in this way. And it should not be a benefit which is limited to a state or city or a country. It should be a global initiative which will benefit everybody.
What?
That's the only criteria I think IBM
has. What does it take to build your private grid?
I think the infrastructure is pretty much open source, right? The Boeing client and the server that is running it is pretty much open source. What you can do is, like, let's say if you are, let's say, interested in doing something in your own organization, wherein it's an organization with so many computation power, like Titan Industries, let's say, for example, has an office and have at least 900 outlets. In every outlet, we have a computer which is doing the billing and recording, right?
Mm.
So if, let's say, we want to understand the, how do I relate to Titan's example? Let's say if you want to understand how can you purify gold or remove the impurities from gold with more cost-effective chemicals from what we are doing right now, right? It's a very closed initiative for an organization. If we can, let's say, get gold at cheaper price, getting processed, we'll definitely want to do it. So I can, what I can do is, like, this is a problem, right, which needs a lot of, again, combinations and permutations with chemicals and what chemicals will have what reactions on gold. So I can distribute this kind of a question on a grid computing project, deploy it, and the processors which are running for doing billing or stuff like that, which are basically not using a lot of processing power, can work on finding solutions. Now, one problem which I think of is, let's say you are doing a particular job, right, for of this huge equation, and you go offline. What happens then? So what happens is, when they build this grid computing, they figured out that some things like that will happen. People will drop out when they are, so they will not be connecting all the time. There will be time when they turn off, when the processing is happening, they turn off and go home. So what happens is, every project that is given to you is also given to four other nodes, similar project. Now what happens is, if you drop out, the central processing notifies the other nodes to, let's say you have not submitted the project that was given to you, went offline, right? So other three nodes, they will have to pause the processing that they were doing, and what task was pending from your side is given to all three nodes, distributed at real time and given to all three nodes. So they pause what they are doing and they take up your work and they complete and send it back to you. So what happens is, it's pretty, it's a system which is not depending on each other, but it has taken, it has factored in all these kind of problems that can happen, because people are connecting from China, from Japan, people are connecting from different parts of the globe where internet connectivity might or not be very strong. And anyways, when you're doing this processing power for 2.5 hours or 3 hours, you don't really have to transmit data every time. Once your full processing is done, then only you transmit it. So the data usage is anyways minimum, because you have downloaded 10 MB, you worked on it for 3 hours, in which those 3 hours you have not used internet connection at all because you're working on something. And the once you're done, you upload it back.
Who are the maximum contributors in terms of number of nodes and countries?
So IBM itself is, obviously,
no,
because
in terms of countries,
America is doing the most, because IBM went ahead and partnered with 300 organizations saying, how can we also install this kind of infrastructure on your servers and computers? Second by China, we are not in top 10. But yeah, so the strange, or I was just looking at the power, like the throughput units and stuff like that, and I figured out that this virtual computer, the grid computing, like the World Community Grid, if you take the outputs in consideration, it is actually faster than the fastest computer in the world, with like a marginal difference, with some very, very marginal petaflops. So it's that, right? You don't really need a supercomputer or a very expensive hardware to perform calculations which are beneficial. You can just give it to IBM, they will understand the problem, they will divide it into various clusters. It is all done at the programming level, of course, because it's a infrastructure that they have developed. So it gets divided into so many clusters, and then it's like a million and millions of clusters, right? Which is a part of a problem. Then you divide it, and then you download one of them. Or so at the end of the day, if tomorrow there is a cure for AIDS, you will be content in a way that you have contributed, let's say, 0.0001%. But because you were there, and because you donated some amount of processing power, and because it mattered to you that how society can get rid of these problems or can be a better place for everybody, it is now possible. It has happened, and it will, because only if we care about these things, it will come to reality. Otherwise, who's going to donate supercomputers to these research scientists? Nobody.
Delayed gratification.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Another thing I personally feel is there's a lot of e-waste that is generated. I mean, there's a lot of old mobiles that we just stop using because of some reason or the other. And, you know, that processing speed is also wasted. Now, if projects like this really come up, we could, you know, just use them for this reason, because anyway we are not going to use the phones.
There need to be a mechanism to connect the phones to the grid first. So most of the old phones with whatever processing
because
donated to an organization that just collects all of it and dedicates it to the grid.
I have a laptop at home. I used to have it. Now it's totally broke. It was a compact HP kind of a laptop, and the battery was totally gone. It was a Centrino Celeron processor. So I just hooked it and set it to maximum usage and left it, because I was anyways on Wi-Fi, and that machine I was anyways going to throw away. So I just plugged it in. It was using some power and was using obviously some amount of my data, but it's okay as long as it is doing something for society. I think Bitcoin mining works in similar ways I have not really gone through in detail of Bitcoin mining, but what happens is it works in the similar concept of grid computing. So what happens is you're donating, you're doing something. So like money never comes to you free in any economy, right? That's why the Bitcoin people have said that you donate certain amount of processing power to the understanding of economics and keeping track of where the money is flowing, the e-money, the Bitcoins are flowing. And we will give you, so whenever transactions happen, you get a 0.0001% or that amount of currency that you get. So it's kind of a gratification quicker way, but it is more complex than what I'm saying. Obviously, you have to keep it on. You have to donate your GPUs and CPU processing power, and you should have a constant connection to download files. So I think Bitcoin understood that the power of processors, which are the cycles which are not being used, at least if we can combine this power, it is like very, very big computer. It's like huge. So they understood, and they're leveraging on it, and so are these projects. So basically, all I have to say is, anyways, just run one program at the background and it can make a difference, because it already has, and it will. That's pretty much it. Questions, if any.